means he has to have big things for you to bring it to... Is there anything that is impossible for God? No, I'm considered he's the one who has given me his word. He's the one who's given me his promises. He's the one that has to bring it to pass.
You know, I was thinking of the ministry of Jesus, and you know, I don't know why artists have rendered him with such a sad look on his face. You know, I mean, I guarantee you he was one of the most joyful, fun to be around people you could ever be around. And they paint pictures like he's just all depressed and was baptized in vinegar oil. And I mean, just this stuff that is not Jesus at all. I believe that when people were healed, I believe that he went dancing and leaping and that he was shouting and running right alongside of them. So grateful to see what God his Father had done. Say God his Father had done. So I tell you, I think sometimes we just have this whole misdirection of what God is about. The kingdom of God, the Bible says, is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So anyway, you know, as we've been going along, I started out several weeks ago along this topic. And I thought I was going to jump just into being led by the Spirit of God. And, you know, I really believe that's kind of... If people wanted to know what identifies Pastor Kevin's ministry, it seems like being led by the Spirit of God is one that I always end up on. But as we started along this line, you know, you have to realize that in order to be led by the Spirit of God, you have to understand how man is created. So I just want to back up and review a few things, and then we're going to move on again today. But the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians, I pray that the Lord God would preserve you wholly, wholly, spirit, soul, and body. So we know by that God has identified that man is a three-part being. First of all, you are a spirit. That means that the real you, the hidden man of the heart, is a spirit being. You are created in the image of God. John 4 says this, it says that God is a spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So God created you in his image. That's what he said in Genesis. Let us create man in our image. We are created in his image, and he's a spirit, and we are a spirit. First and foremost, we are a spirit. God has also given us a soul. And the soul is the mind and the will and the emotions. The soul is separate from the spirit. And then he's given us a body. Thank God, right? Some of you might not be saying thank God for my body, but it's what you have. And as long as you are going to be here on this earth, you have to have this body. Just like if we were to go into space and walk on the moon, in order to even survive and function in space, we would have to have a certain type of suit on to function in that atmosphere and in that place. And God gave every one of us a suit that we have to operate in as long as we are here on this earth. And so when we look at the soul is the mind and the will and the emotions, or we could call it this, we could call it the psyche. When we look at the flesh is what it is. Now, a lot of people, they get into condemnation, they get into bondage, because they've never rightly divided the word of truth, which is able to deliver their souls. And this is the thing, this is what the Bible talks about. The Bible talks about that there's this stuff going on here. You are born again. If you've called on the name of Jesus, if you've confessed him with your mouth, if you believe that he was raised again from the dead after 3 days, and that he's alive today, seated at the right hand of God, then you are a new creation. You've been born again. But what was born again is your spirit man. Your spirit man received the very nature of God on the inside of you. But here's the kicker. Your flesh didn't get born again. That's why if you were handsome before you got saved, you're still handsome. If you weren't so handsome before you got born again, you're still not so handsome. Because that's not what changed. That's not what received eternal life. The Bible says that this flesh, that it's growing weary, it's growing old, that it's decaying. But the inward man, The real man, the hidden man of the heart that's been born again. The Bible says it's being renewed day by day by day by day. So this flesh is put on corruption. It's in the process. Every one of you in here, your flesh is in the process of dying. Every one of you. But your inner man is not in any process of dying. Every day, I mean every day with you, Lord, is brighter than the day before. Your inner man, it's renewed. Your inner man is what received eternal life. Your inner man is what, when your body decays and your body goes back into the, your inner man is what is going to spend in the presence of God throughout all eternity. Yeah. And so lots of times what's happened is people who have given their heart to the Lord and they love Jesus, but yet their body still wants to do the wrong thing. And so then the enemy takes advantage of them because they don't understand how God created us as a three-part being. And so the enemy will jump on their shoulder and he will ask them questions. He will say, who do you think you are? How can you say that you really love Jesus? How can you say that you've received Jesus as your Savior if you still wanted to cut that person off that cut you off in traffic? Right? Well, why is it? Because your flesh isn't born again. Your flesh is flesh. Your flesh still wants to do the wrong thing. Your flesh still has received, it still has the sin nature is in your flesh. And so then you have your soul, and your soul is your mind, will, and emotions. And your soul, thank God that we have a soul. I'm glad some of you have a mind, aren't you? Yeah. Amen. I mean, God gave us a mind. He gave us our mental faculties. He wants us to use them, but he doesn't want them to control us. Do you hear what I'm saying? He does not want our emotions to control us. He wants us to control our emotions. See, there's people that based on their emotions, it's already predetermined for them how they feel, whether they're going to have a good day or a bad day. What determined it? What determined it was how they felt. And so this whole carnal nature, the Bible says it's carnal. This whole carnal nature is what we can see, what we can hear, what we can smell, what we can touch, what we can taste, our five senses. So we're stuck in this earth suit and we function with our five senses, and it's important that we do. Aren't you glad that when you touch something hot, your flesh recoils and you say, ouch, right? God gave us these senses. I mean, don't you love it when you can smell a steak cooking on the grill, done medium, filet mignon, baked potato, sour cream, butter, salt and pepper, and a salad? I mean, aren't you glad you got senses? And in the same sense, aren't you glad you have emotions? I mean, people have this idea about God like he's just some monotone. And he sits behind the curtain, and he pushes the buttons and pulls the levers, and he shows no kind of emotion. But the Bible says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Well, that means the Lord has joy, right? And so here we have this thing. So we have our mind and our will and emotions, or our soul, and it's attached to our spirit. So let's pick up here in Hebrews, the 4th chapter, the 12th verse. It says, for the word of God... I'm going to do this in the Amplified. It makes it louder. For the word that God speaks, say that God speaks, is alive and full of power, making it active, operative, energizing, and effective. Now notice this. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. It's penetrating to the dividing line of the breath of life, the soul, and the immortal spirit, and of joints and marrows of the deepest parts of our nature, exposing, sifting, analyzing, and judging the very thoughts and purposes of our heart. So it's the word of God, or the word that God speaks, both of them, the written word, and God is still speaking today. We'll talk about that here in a minute. And it's the word of God that is also, that is actually able to go in and to divide, that's what it says, to divide asunder soul from spirit. That means they're connected. And there's only one thing that is available to you that can divide it asunder. Only one thing, and it is the word of God. And the word of God is able to go in and divide it. What I could say it this way is that when the word of God comes in and divides it, you will know, is that the soul? Is that just my mind? Is that just me thinking that? Is it my emotions? Is it just because I'm just really emotional about that? Is that what it is? Is it because I'm emotional? Is it just I'm emotional and I'm just hoping so? Or is that really God? And so it's the Word of God that you will be able to ascertain, is that just my emotions? Is that just my thinking? Is that just my mind? Is that just my will? Or was that really God? So it takes this Word, takes the Word that God speaks, and it divides it. I love this. It divides it. It shows you. It spreads it apart. You've often heard me say this. I've probably repeated this several times the past few weeks. But it seems like when you need to hear something from God, the most is when you are emotionally invested in something, or you're going through maybe a physical challenge in your body. Symptoms are hitting your body, you know, and you're feeling pain or whatever, and that's when you need to hear from God the most. But at the same time, that's when your flesh is screaming the most, and that's the same time that your emotions are going crazy and going wacky. And so when we need to hear from God the most, it seems like to me that all these things are against us. But there's one thing that God will do. He will communicate with your spirit. When He communicates with your spirit, then you know you've heard from God, and it doesn't matter what it looks like over here. Your emotions will get in line because you have heard from God. People like, you hear from God, and then they go, doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. Every born-again believer who has the Spirit of God in them hears from God. And one of the ways, the first and the foremost way that we hear from God is we hear what was written in His Word. This is God speaking to you. And He said what He meant, and He meant what He said, and He didn't change His mind to make it culturally acceptable or relevant. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He never changes. That's what He said in His Word. And if He said it 5,000 years ago, He still means it today. He didn't change His mind. He said, I am the God and I never change. And He loves that He gave us His Word, because He said that He watches over His Word to perform it in our lives. Aren't you glad about that? That's why He said, when I send my Word, He said, I'm going to make sure that it prospers, and I'm going to make sure that it comes to pass. That's why if you are going to be somebody that knows how to hear from God, you're going to have to be somebody who knows the Word of God. Amen. So important. Because you can't leave church today and then go rob Quickstar and get arrested and then come talk to me for counseling and say, Pastor, the Spirit of God led me to rob. See, I would know that was a lie. Why? Because the Bible already said, thou shalt not steal. Well, I'm the exception. No, there is no exceptions. You are not the exception. There's no exceptions. Oh, Lord, we just... You can tread on toes. I mean, when you talk about this stuff, because people get all these goofy ideas that God told them to do something, but there's no word to back it up. God is never going to tell you to do something contrary to what He said in His Word. Why? We have to have it. The Word is our standard. The Word is our foundation. The Word is our base. The Word is what we compare every other thing to. How does that line up with the Word of God? And if it doesn't line up with the Word of God, then we need to just cast it aside and not go that direction. And it's all right. Listen, it's all right to be bold as Christians. Somebody's telling you something, say, listen, show me chapter and verse. I want to see book, chapter, and verse. Well, I don't have no book, chapter, and verse. Like one guy told Kenneth Hagin, he said, well, I'm way beyond that book. Brother Hagin said, well, you're way beyond any place I ever want to go. Right. Why? Because this is still pertinent for today. This is still God speaking to us. Just say this out loud. Say, this is God, speaking to me through His written Word. So let's go here a little bit further. Let's bear this out a little bit more. Proverbs 3. It says this in the 5th verse. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all of thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy paths. Do not be wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. So this breaks it down for us right here. We trust in the Lord with all of our... We don't lean to our own In all our ways, we acknowledge Him and He directs our path. So that tells me that we don't trust in the Lord with our understanding. It also tells me that we have the potential that we want to invest everything into what we can understand. And sometimes when we do that based on what we understand and based on what we see, then really we are not trusting in the Lord. Because the Lord can be leading you to go this direction, but your understanding's trying to get involved and say, why should I go that direction? It looks like I'm going the wrong way. But the Lord knows it's the right way, so we have to trust in Him. And not lean to our own understanding. Now, let me say this again. It's good that you have understanding. As a matter of fact, Paul in the book of Ephesians, in several of his books, he said that he was praying that the Lord God would open the eyes of our understanding. We have understanding that He would reveal to us that we might know what is the hope of our calling, and that we might know what is the exceeding greatness of His riches, and that we might know what is the power in His resurrection. He wants us to know some things, and He said, this is how you're going to know, hear this, this is how you're going to know these things. The way you're going to know these things is that the eyes of your understanding have to be enlightened. That's how we know those things. In 1 Corinthians, the 14th chapter, it says this in the 14th verse, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. What is it then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also. Now, the reason I wanted to use this verse is, first of all, we're Pentecostal, and we're not ashamed of that. We believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. But it also, what I wanted to use this for, is it breaks down, once again, your spirit from your understanding. Isn't that what he said? I'm going to do things. I'm going to pray and I'm going to sing. I'm going to do it two different ways. I'm going to sing with the spirit, and then I'm going to sing with my understanding, and then I'm going to pray with my spirit, and I'm going to pray with my understanding. So your spirit man, listen, your spirit man can be praying with your understanding not even being engaged. And it can pray and it can sing that way. I like how the Amplified says it. It says, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit by the Holy Spirit within me prays. Say, my spirit by the Holy Spirit within me prays. But my understanding, you don't have to repeat that, sorry. My understanding is not fruitful. But it's my spirit with the help of the Holy Spirit prays. My understanding still doesn't get it. This is so important if we're going to be led by the Spirit of God. You see, a lot of people are moved by so many different things. They're moved by how they feel. They're moved by what they see. They're moved by their circumstances. They're moved by all sorts of things. Well, Lord, if that door opens, it must be you. Or, Lord, I didn't get that job. Must not have been your will. I mean, just all sorts of different things. But you know what? We're not to be moved by any of those things. We're supposed to be moved by what we believe. And what we believe is based on what God has said in His Word and what God has spoken to our hearts. Remember Hebrews 4:12? For the Word that God speaks is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And so last Sunday we said this, that you have an unction from the Holy One and you know all things. That's what the Bible says. If you're a born-again believer, you should never, ever say this, and we've all been guilty of it. I don't know. I don't understand. I don't know what I'm going to do. Because there's someone on the inside of you. It's an anointing, it says, and it abides in you. 1 John 2:27 says it this way, but the anointing which you have received of Him abides in you. That means it lives in you. And you need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you of all things and is truth and is no lie, even as it has taught you, you shall abide in Him. I keep saying this, we have to become more God-incited minded. The master of the universe. I'm not talking some sci-fi show. The master of the universe. God Himself, the creator of the universe. The creator who created mankind. The God who knew every single person. He knew you before you were even formed in your mother's womb. Try to wrap your mind around that. He knew what your comings and goings would be. He knew what your end days and your last days. He knew what they would be. He knew every single thing about you. He knows everything about everything. And He actually lives on the inside of you. My goodness, that ought to make you just put a little oomph in your step and put your shoulders back. Greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. There's no test or difficulty that I can't overcome because he's on the inside of me. There's nothing that is rattling God's mind, so there's nothing that's going to rattle my mind. There's no question that it's too hard for God to solve. No problem too hard for God to solve. Like we sing, there's nothing too hard for him. And he lives on the inside of me, and he said that I have this unction and that he will teach me, and he even went as far to say is that he would show me things to come, future events. My goodness, you don't have to get caught off guard. You don't have to be caught by an element of surprise. Glory, he's on the inside of us. John 14:26 says this, and this is out of the Amplified again. But the Comforter, and I love this list, I call it a job description. What's that word Comforter mean? Counselor. Anybody in here ever need counseling? Thank God for in the multitude of counsels. Counselors, there's wisdom. But guess what? You got the counselor living on the inside of you. Sometimes you just got to step back and say, Lord, you need to counsel me on this. Lord, I don't know what I'm supposed to do here. I'm just gonna spend some time. I'm just gonna wait on you. You've got this, God. It's kind of boggling my mind right now, but Lord, you know what to do. Lord, I don't see a way out of this situation. I don't see what else I can do, but Lord, you see everything. And you know everything. I need your counsel right here. He's our intercessor. That means he goes to God on our behalf. We'll talk about that here in a minute. He goes to Jesus and God and comes back. He's our advocate. That's like a legal term. Aren't you glad you got a defense attorney? I remember I knew a guy when I lived in Florida, and he belonged to this group. And it's where everybody basically pools all their money together, and then anytime you need any kind of legal assistance, then you already have it because you've paid it like on a monthly basis. And so, and basically it's kind of like multi-level, and you can get it and you can sell your friends and family and stuff, and you make money off of what they're doing. Well, it's one of those kind of things. But listen, there is no better attorney that you can find to represent you than the Holy Spirit living on the inside of you. He is the advocate. He knows how to act in the courtroom of heaven. He knows how to show the utmost respect to the judge of all the earth, God the Father. And just think, he goes on your behalf to God the Father. He defends you. He defends you. He advocates for you. He intercedes for you. And this is the beautiful thing about it, is that the verdict has already been drawn. Because you know what the evidence is? The evidence is the shed blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the mercy seat. Been sprinkled there. When God looks at somebody that calls upon the name of Jesus and the enemy has been accusing them to God, you know what God sees? He sees you and he sees that you are somebody who's called on the name of Jesus, that you've called out and you've repented of your sin, and he sees this blood and it filters out, it blots out every sin you had ever committed. You stand clean in front of him. You stand justified. I mean, just this thing's already rigged against you. I mean, Jesus is your defense attorney, and his father, and your father's the judge. This is looking pretty good. I mean, you already got favor. You know which way they want to rule. And so they just said, bam, innocent. Yeah, but you did this, and you did that, and you did that. Innocent, I said. Case closed. What made you innocent? Was it your actions? The only action that made you innocent was that you received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you confessed your sin, and you still do. Even if you've been serving God for 90 years, you still need to be faithful, just like God is. And when you mess up, run to God immediately. Don't run from him. Just run to him. Say, Father God, I messed up. He said in 1 John 1:8-9, that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That settles it. If we'll just go to God, I messed up. Anybody in here never mess up? Anybody in here mess up this morning? You don't have to lift your hands. Well, there's some. See, that's right. Well, that's good to be like that. But you know what? When you mess up, you say, God, I messed up. Forgive me. You said if I would confess my sin, I'm confessing it. This is what I did. I'm sorry I did it. I repent of it, Father God. And then you do it and you say, God, I'm so glad that you've forgiven me. You know why that's important? Because later on this afternoon, the enemy's going to say, you know what you did this morning? Who do you think you are? And you're going to say, I know what I did this morning. I repented and I confessed my sin and I'm clean from it right now. Anyway, he's your advocate. He's your strengthener. I'm telling you, you know, a lot of people don't realize this. But one of the greatest needs that you need strengthened is in your inner man. In your inner man. A lot of people think another 10 naps, that will solve the problem. And very often it has nothing to do with your physical, it's your spiritual. It's the place you find yourself spiritually that's affecting every area of your life. Amen. Well, keep on moving. That doesn't go over very big on a Sunday morning, but here we are. He's your standby, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, in my place, to represent me and act on my behalf. He will teach you all things. He will cause you to recall and will remind you of and bring to your remembrance everything I have told you. The 16th chapter of John, the 7th verse, beginning there, says this, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the prince of the world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will receive of mine and show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I, that he will take of mine, and he will show it unto you. Now let's just look at this here a little bit further, because you have to realize he was telling his disciples, I'm getting ready to go away. This is Jesus. He'd been walking with them, space of 3.5 years. Can you imagine how effective that ministry was? Jesus' ministry was so effective that for 3.5 years, he changed the way we even count time. It went from B.C. to A.D. In his ministry, he only lived about 33.5 years on the earth. And his ministry was only a total of 3.5 years, but yet he changed society. He changed civilization. He changed mankind. Pretty effective. Well, he had 30 years of preparation. That should encourage some of us. Lord, when? Lord, when? Lord, when? Well, Jesus had 30 years of preparation for 3.5 years of ministry. But it was the most effective. So he said that he was going to come and that he was going to tell us some things. In the let me read it this way in the Amplified, in the 13th verse. But when he, the Spirit of truth, the truth-giving Spirit comes, he will guide you into all the truth, the whole truth, the full truth. He will not speak his own message on his own authority. He will tell whatever he hears from the Father. He will give the message that has been given to him. He will announce and declare to you the things that are to come, that will happen in the future. He will honor and glorify me because he will take of and receive and draw upon what is mine and will reveal, declare, disclose, and transmit it to you. Everything that the Father has is mine. That is what I meant when I said that he, the Spirit, will take the things that are mine and reveal, declare, disclose, and transmit them to you. So he was on this earth. His disciples, I mean, Jesus is getting ready to be crucified. And his disciples, I mean, they're kind of bummed out, wouldn't you be? Took them a while to even figure out what was going on. But Jesus said it this way. He said, it's expedient for you that I go away. He said it this way. He said, it is necessary. That's what that means. It is necessary for you that I go away. Because if I don't go away, then I can't send the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. Oh, I love that he went away, don't you? Jesus could only be one place at one time. The Holy Spirit can be every place at every time. Do you know there's people in nations all around this world that the Holy Spirit lives in right now? There's people having church all around the universe. People praising God. Same Holy Spirit that lives in them lives in you. There isn't multiple Holy Spirits. There's only one Spirit of God. And he's on the inside of every single believer. That's exciting stuff if you ask me. So the number one way, we talked about this last week, the number one way that the Lord leads us, we find in Romans the 8th chapter, the 14th verse. Say, this is the number one way. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Sons of God, we could say daughters of God. The Bible was written neutral, gender neutral. Sons of God are those that have been born again, are to be led by the Spirit of God. That's what he's saying here. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they're the sons of God. Now, if we go to the 16th verse, it says this, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So here we're supposed to be led by the Spirit of God, and then he tells us one of the ways that we are led by the Spirit of God is that his Spirit bears witness with our spirit. Let's talk about that for a minute. His Spirit bears witness with our spirit. It's a spiritual sense, but sometimes you feel it in the natural too. Have you ever been having a conversation and somebody's sharing something with you, and you know when they're talking to you that this is God? And all of a sudden, your spirit man grabs a hold of it, and sometimes you even feel it. Sometimes you can feel the witness. You can feel the presence of God. That is him bearing witness with your spirit. I said this last week, but then there's other times you don't necessarily feel something physical. I mean, you can feel goosebumps and doodads on your goosebumps. And there's been times it felt like every hair on my body was just standing up. I mean, just from the electrified from the presence of God. That's all good. Sometimes the presence of God gets on you so strong. It's just like the day of Pentecost. You act like you're drunk. You're just discombobulated. You're just. And so we might end up there if we're not careful. Oh, glory. But you sense his presence. And then there's other times you don't feel it like that. It's more like this. I can't put my finger on it, but that's not right. Yeah, man. Well, it looks great. You know, it looks like, man, that's gotta be God. But something on the inside of you is like, no. That's still his witness. That's still a witness of the Spirit. It's he's witness to your spirit. I likened it to this, that a green light means go, right? A red light means stop. A yellow light means punch it to the floor and go through it. No, it doesn't. A yellow light means that we're supposed to slow down and we're to proceed with caution. And so as God is leading us by the Spirit, sometimes they're just a green light. Man, you just know it. And then you might, the light on the inside of it turns yellow, and you're just like, okay, I need to be cautious about this. I need to slow down. Need to check both ways. See what I'm saying? And then there's other times, it's just like you're going, and it's just like, stop, come to a stop, halt, no further. This isn't the way. Sometimes you got to make that U-turn in life and get back on the place you're supposed to be. I remember years ago, I was working for a place, and they wanted to change the way that they paid me. They hired me with one agreement. I'd worked there probably a year and a half. And they, partway through, they wanted to change the way they paid all of their salespeople. And I'm like, what? This isn't what I signed up for. This isn't fair. You know, that's how we like to think. And so I learned a long time ago, and this is good advice for everybody in here. I learned a long time ago that we just don't randomly open our mouth and complain about stuff. And especially, listen, in the context of work, you know, you still have people over you. And you still have to respect them. And very often, the person that gave you the good news or bad news, it didn't come from them. It came from the top. Amen? And so I laugh sometimes because sometimes the ushers get in trouble for what I told them to do. And you guys blame them, and it's coming from me. But I like that I have fall guys. But anyway, anyway, they're going to change the way I was paid. And so I started asking the Lord, and I just sensed in my heart. I just felt like it just seemed this is going to be all right. This is going to be all right. It's just going to be all right. And so I didn't open my mouth. I just, you know, I was actually ready to go in and sit down, you know, sit down and have a talk, have a discussion. And what they were doing is they were taking away my base. A base when you're in sales is nice, because that means you get a paycheck when things are slim, right? And sales are down. And that base, you know, if you almost think about it, you can become very dependent on the base. And, you know, well, we could go there, but, you know, that's where many of us live. We like that. We like that crutch. We like that knowing, you know, that I have this to fall back, and if sales go bad, you know, I'm going to be all right this month. Well, you know, that's not putting a whole lot of trust in God. That's putting trust in the base. And so anyway, they're going to take that away, and we're going to go straight commission. And you know what? I'm so glad that I heard from God. I'm so glad that he bore witness with my spirit, because from that next time, that next pay period, when we changed that, my sales went up, up, up. My income went up, 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 up. Hey, they might have done that just for me and didn't even know it. They did that just for Kevin. That's like, man, I want to bless him. I want to get a blessing to him. We're going to have to change some things up so that he can get further and I can do more for him. And so then there's that way. And then we ended here last Sunday about our conscience. In Hebrews 10, 19 through 23, it says this: having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say the flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And so what that says is that we have to have a clear conscience. Your spirit, if it is born again, and even before you are born again, God created you with a conscience. The world likes to lie and come up with their own ideas, but every single human being, God put a conscience in them. They know by nature evil from good. But what happens, like we talked about last week, is you could continually override that. And when you continually override your conscience, it becomes seared. It is no longer a good guide for you. Because what used to bother you, what used to prick your heart, what used to prick your conscience, and you knew this is wrong, I shouldn't be doing this, because you continue to override that and continue to override that, your conscience becomes quiet. Dangerous place for anybody to be in, especially dangerous place for Christians. Because the Bible tells us in 1 John, it talks about our heart. And it says that if our heart condemns us, then we don't have confidence in God. He was talking about here, let us hold fast our faith, having a full assurance and having boldness. If your conscience is bothering you, if your heart, it's not God condemning you. Hear me now. Who God condemns is those who haven't called on Jesus. He convicts them of sin, the sin of needing Jesus in their life so that they can be delivered from that sin nature. That's what he convicts. That's what he convicts people who don't know Jesus of. But your own heart will convict you. Your own heart will condemn you. Your own heart will bother you. I remember years ago, you've heard this story. My son, I won't have him stand this morning, but he was a little boy, and he got in trouble. And I didn't know he got in trouble. Mary didn't know he got in trouble. But yet his conscience was bothering him. You know what? You know one of the greatest things about discipline is? Discipline brings an end to it. Discipline, when you discipline a child, when we get disciplined by the Lord, which he disciplines us, then what it does is it brings it to a head, it comes out in the open, and there's almost like a relief. I've dealt with it, the Lord's dealt with me, or as a parent, we've dealt with it, okay, I'm free from this now, I'm free from the guilt, I'm free from trying to hide it, now I can go on. This is truth. See, people have all sorts of ideas about discipline, and we won't go there this morning, but I believe the Bible. And so my son, he comes up, and he says, Dad, he said, I need a spanking. Now, he was always a masochist, but no, I'm just kidding. He's just a little boy. He says, I need a spanking. Well, you know, I look back in my history. I don't ever recall going to my mom. She's up here in the front. I don't ever recall going to my dad and say, you know what? I really need a spanking. I was always the opposite. I was the kid that one time put Dr. Seuss books in his britches because I knew I was getting ready to have it. That's the kid I was. I never went and said, spank me, I need a spanking. But this is what it was. His heart was tender to God, and his conscience was bothering him. See, that's how we have to be. We've got to keep our heart tender towards God. When our conscience wants to say, God, I mean, God's not going to spank us with sickness and disease and poverty and everything that he's ever delivered us from through Jesus, anything he's redeemed us from. He doesn't use that to punish us. But what he'll do is he'll look and he'll want us to make corrections in our heart. Amen. And then once we've made those corrections in our heart, that's what I'm talking about, then your heart no longer condemns you. My son's heart no longer condemned him. I mean, spanking, and, 10 minutes later, he's out there, everything's good. I probably should have spanked him harder, but I'm just kidding. But that's how God created us, to have a clear conscience. Say a clear conscience. And then we'll hit one more here before we go this morning. In Acts, the 27th chapter, the 9th verse. Now, this is Paul. Paul had been taken into custody. He had appealed to go to Rome to appear before Caesar to plead his case. His case was he was taken into custody basically for preaching Jesus Christ, preaching the gospel. And so they're getting ready to go on a ship so that he can get to Rome. And it says this in the 9th verse. It says, now when much time was spent and when sailing was now dangerous because the fast was now already past, Paul admonished them and he said unto them, sirs, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage, not only of the lading and ship, but also of our lives. Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which were spoken by Paul. So Paul had this perception. He perceived something. Have you ever heard that? He perceived. It was a perception that he had. The ship was in the ship was in the harbor. Everything was looking good. If you read the whole account, it says now when they had determined that sailing would be good, they moved on and they went to this place. They were trying to get to this harbor that they could spend the winter there. And all the professional sailors, come on, all the wizards of sailing smart, I mean, they're all saying, this looks good. This is the time to go. I mean, this is, let's go do it. But Paul knew something on the inside of him. It wasn't based on that he could tell because he'd ridden on a ship a couple times on a cruise and he knew that the winds were going to... It was based on nothing like that. It was based on one thing. On the inside, he had a perception that there is danger ahead. And it was such a perception that he went and he talked to the guy at the head of the ship and said, listen, this is not a good idea. I perceive there's danger ahead, not only to the ship and its cargo, but to people. And of course, they didn't listen to him. The owner of the ship didn't listen to them, and they went on the. They began to take on the journey. Now that word "perceive" means to know by experience and observation, and that word "know" in the Greek it means a fuller or a full knowledge, a fuller or a full knowledge. Do you know when you perceive something, it's a fuller knowledge? It's a full knowledge. Now, you can't necessarily go and put your fingers on it, this is what it is, but you just know on the inside of them. I think it's kind of interesting because here he is when they're on the journey. And, of course, they're starting to freak out because here comes this Euroclidean is what it says in the Greek. This means this was hurricane force stuff, hurricane force. And it's getting dangerous out there. They didn't listen to Paul. They should have. It's getting dangerous out there. And here the ship is rocking and rolling. They're throwing cargo off the side. They're taking ropes and they're putting them underneath and they're trying to hold the ship together from breaking apart. They couldn't even sail. They just had to put the anchor down, let go of the sails, and let the wind push it any way they wanted to go. And it says, and after many days, say after many days. This is what Paul did. After many days, Paul stood up and he said this, sirs, you should have listened to me. But you got to understand, they're still in the midst of the storm. Nothing has changed. The only thing that changed is what Paul is about ready to tell them. We could say it this way. He's holding on to one of the masts. Water's coming up over the side. And water's hitting. He's going, you should have listened to me. And how come I told you? And they're like, I mean, guys are probably ralphing. And I mean, it's not a good sight by any means. They've gone days without eating. And then he said this. He said, an angel from the Lord, whom I serve, he appeared unto me. And he said, it's going to be all right. But he'd be going, he said, it's going to be all right. In the waters, yeah, he said, everything is going to be all right. I mean, we don't get the whole picture. We don't get the whole picture of what's really happening. Does it really look like it's going to be all right? I mean, it's going to be all right. And water's coming over his head. I said, it's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. See, he said, be of good cheer. Cheer up. He said this. Cheer up. Why are you so dumb? Cheer up. Pulling seaweed off from around his neck. Cheer up. You haven't eaten in a number of days. Let's eat. And food, they were all fasting. They were all seeking, well, he was seeking the God he serves. Aren't you glad? I'm sure he was glad. He said, it's going to be all right. 14 days later, what the angel told him was right. They ended up on an island. Think of this guy. He gets on the island. They start a fire. He picks up some wood. This is Apostle Paul. Picks up some wood to throw on the fire. A viper comes out and gets him by the hand. All the people on the island are looking at him, waiting for him to puff up and fall over dead. Other ones are saying, you know what? He was a bad criminal. He escaped the windstorm. He escaped the hurricane. He escaped the shipwreck, but God still got him. I like what he did. He just shook that old snake, threw it off in the fire. They all stood around waiting for him to fall over, puffed up dead, and he was all right. Then he had a healing revival. People started bringing sick people from all over the island, and he got people healed, turned them to the Lord. But my whole point is, 14 days later, let me just say this. We do need to go home. Let me just say this. It started out with a perception. A perception. Perceive something. That's why every time I get in on an airplane, I got my perceiver out there. I said, Lord, is this all right? And I'm listening on the inside. I'm just looking. I'm just waiting. Is this all right, Lord? Sometimes I look out the window and, Lord Jesus, I plead the blood over my luggage. It's making it to the other side. And don't let them beat it up like they're doing that one right there. I'm praying for the guys out there fueling the airplane, Lord, the maintenance guys on the plane, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We're going over there. Now, Lord, we're going to the other side, but you know, I'm willing to get off here. I'm willing to get off this plane if that's what you want me to do. So it started out with this perception. Say this perception. That perception, this is why I'm going here. That perception is enough. It's enough. That perception in the beginning was all you needed. That was enough from the Lord. Thing is there were things that were out of his control. He was a prisoner. You know, every prisoner would probably come up with a reason they didn't want to get on that ship, you know? But they wouldn't listen to him. But then when he got out there, we could say it this way. It started out with a supernatural leading by the Holy Spirit. A supernatural. That perception that God gave him was supernatural. It didn't come from what you could see in the natural, because everything looked great. It looked like this is a good time to sail. But it was had nothing to do with something. It was something he perceived on the inside of him. And so he started out with the perception, but then notice when it really got bad, it wasn't a perception. It was supernatural that an angel spoke to him. But we could say it this way, it was spectacular. You see, a lot of people, they miss the supernatural because they're looking for the spectacular. They're looking for a spectacular way for God to lead me. Lord, I'll do that. Just send an angel. Have an angel appear to me. Have Jesus appear to me in the flesh. Oh, Lord, let me look out in the sky and see handwriting up in the sky in the clouds. Then I'll know it's you. Or like the king with the handwriting on the wall. Give me handwriting on the wall. Lord, have somebody just come up and tell me what I'm supposed to do. You see, if that's how we are geared in and if that's what we're looking for, it's very easy because we're looking for that. We're missing the witness of the Spirit. We're missing the things that God is putting in our spirits that He wants us to perceive. And then we have where the Holy Spirit, when you perceive something, you perceive it in your spirit. But then there's other times where the Holy Spirit speaks up on the inside of you. It's not your spirit. It's more authoritative. I remember I was going to the office when we were living in Lakeland before I was in the ministry. I used to drive this road every day, twice a day, to the office. Sometimes more than that because I was out on the road a lot in sales. And I'd be going down this road. And when I come to this intersection, there's a railroad bridge. And it's a weird intersection. And it's like a blind turn to go underneath the railroad track and then back over to the left. And there's a stoplight here and a stoplight here. And there are two different stoplights, two different traffic. And I'm going down that road. I drove it every day, minding my own business. And I heard on the inside of me, slow down. It wasn't the still, small voice. It wasn't, man, I perceive I ought to let off the gas. I was like, slow down. There was an authority to it. And the first thing I looked at is, am I speeding? And I wasn't. I was doing the speed limit. And I come through that intersection. I go underneath that railroad bridge. I come up to the light. And here comes a car, flew right in front of me. Ran a red light. Flew right across my path in front of me. And we missed. What if I wouldn't have slowed down? That timing, I mean, who knows? Injured, killed, damaged to my vehicle for sure. But see, the Lord knew. The Lord knew. And I believe he had to be more authoritative. You know, He loves me. He loves me so much, He'd do that for me. And He'll do it for you too. He's no respecter of persons. But I believe He was more authoritative like that because if I just would have perceived something, would I have been quick enough? We're just talking seconds. We're not talking minutes. We're talking, you know, less than a minute that I have to slow down and go through that curve. We don't, you know, we can't stop and have a prayer meeting or anything right there. This is going to happen right now. Man, I'm glad I listened. I'm glad I know His voice. This is what I'm talking about. A lot of people say, well, was that just me thinking? Or was that really the Holy Spirit speaking to me as they go through the intersection and get in a car accident? There was this man and his wife. He was a pastor. They were going to go on vacation. And they were out packing the car, and they're ready to go. And the whole time they're packing the car, the pastor's saying, man, we shouldn't go. I don't think we should go. I don't think we should go. We just need to go. But like I always say, if you grew up in my house, when it was vacation time, you left early. So it's kind of a family joke. But anyway, he's out packing the car, and they get in the car, and they go down the road just a few miles, and a car crosses the center line and hits him, kills the man's wife, and injures this man seriously. And see, this is the thing, because religion will says, well, the Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Oh, bless His holy name. Religion says God needed another tulip in the flower bed of heaven. The world says, well, when it's your time, it's your time. No. That man later on, he said, if I would have listened, the Lord was telling me, don't go, don't go, don't go, don't go, don't go. What if he just would have yielded and said, now, Lord, what's this about? How many seconds does it take to miss a head-on collision? One. What if he just would have paused and said, okay, Lord, I'm sensing this. I'm perceiving this. I just sense, Father, something doesn't seem right. You know what our heads would do? Well, why don't you want me to go, Lord? This would have saved his life. Well, Lord, why don't you want me to go? What's going on here? Let me pray about this for a second. He might have prayed like 2 minutes, and all of a sudden the Lord would give him a release. Okay. And spared his life. His life would have been spared. You see why we need to understand this? why we have to be led by the Spirit? None of you ever have to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. None of you ever have to be in the vicinity of a terrorist attack. None of our kids ever have to be in a school where there would be a shooting. Come on. None of you ever have to be involved in an aircraft accident or a car accident. None of you ever have to lose all your money because you put it in the wrong place. None of you ever have to be in a place where people can take advantage of you and lie to you. Let's stand to our feet. Well, welcome back. I sure hope that you enjoyed today's broadcast. Now listen, I have a really important question that I want to ask you, and then I want to pray with you. If you were to die today, do you know where you would spend eternity? If you don't, you can know. This gospel message is a no-so about salvation. It's not a hope-so.
Amen.
If you would like to receive Jesus today, I just want you to simply repeat this prayer after me. Just say this. Say, Father.
Father.
That's right. Say it out loud right in your home. Father.
Father.
I come to you in Jesus' name.
I come to you in Jesus' name.
And I realize that I am lost.
And I realize that I am
lost. And I am undone.
And I am undone.
And that I'm a sinner.
And that I'm a sinner.
I ask that you forgive me.
I ask that you forgive
me. I repent of my sins right now.
I repent of my sins right now.
Jesus.
Jesus.
I believe that you died on the cross for me.
I believe that you died on the cross for
me. And that after 3 days you were raised again from the dead.
And after 3 days you were raised again from the
dead. And you're alive right now.
And you're alive right now.
You're seated at the right hand of God the Father.
You're seated at the right hand of God the Father.
I ask that you come into my life.
I ask that you come into my
life. Right now.
Right now.
To stay.
To stay.
Come into my life.
Come into my life.
This day.
This day.
Flesh.
Flesh.
You are no longer in control.
You are no longer in control.
Sin.
Sin.
You've been broken off my life.
You've been broken off my life.
Devil.
Devil.
You have no more power in my life.
You have no more power in my life.
Jesus is alive inside of me.
Jesus is alive inside of me.
Now listen, if you said that prayer, according to Romans the 10th chapter, it says that if we would confess our sin and we would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and confess it with our mouth, that we would be saved. I've got great news for you. According to the Bible, you are saved. You are justified. Amen. It's just as if you'd never sinned. You have a clean slate. You're starting brand new, and you are in right standing with God. It's very important now that you continue on in your walk with the Lord. You need to have a Bible. You need to read your Bible. You need to pray to God. You just talk to Him like you would talk to somebody. Talk and then listen. And another important thing you need to do is you need to find yourself a good Bible-believing church that preaches the Word of God.
Amen.
And get in fellowship with other people. Have other people surrounded all around you who have Jesus in their heart and who believe what you now believe.
Amen.
Well, God bless you. We look forward to seeing you next time on the next broadcast of Total Impact.